Right, thank you. It's a real pleasure to be in Franklin and Williamson County Library to do this. And let me just give you a little background. I am on the faculty at the law school at Vanderbilt. And I have been teaching law for, well, I won't say how long. Mostly environmental law and natural resources law. And I became interested in agriculture and the environment many years ago. That's been a focus of my work on from the environmental law point of view. Only recently did I get more interested in food as a broad topic. food has become a topic of interest across the universities. We have courses in anthropology and religion and environmental studies, all focused on food. There's even a course in the English department on food and the literature of food. I kind of became interested in it in a broad way when my older son, who's here tonight, was at Wake Forest University as an undergrad. And the university used food as a cross-campus focal point for a lot of different departments. So if you were in a class, upper level class, you might look at food from a religion point of view, an anthropology point of view, etc. So you got exposed to food as an issue that was sort of trans policy. And I thought it was a pretty neat idea, and I wanted to learn more about food. And the best way to learn about something new when you teach at a law school is you offer a seminar and you admit up front, I don't know anything about this, we're gonna learn about it together, but you find materials and you structure a course of study. But it's nice and informal and loose, and it lets the students kind of explore what their deep dive is gonna be on this very broad topic. So I designed a seminar called The Food System. And I knew that the food as in general was gaining interest across in the law student world. Other law schools have food law clinics, food law master's degrees. Vanderbilt's a pretty small school, and I was the only person who wanted to sort of put my foot in that water, so I offered the seminar, and it was just on the food system in the broadest sense. And you know, if you offer a seminar at the law school, you cap it at 16 students. You don't have any more than that, because that way you can work with these students one-on-one, writing papers and things like that. Usually you get maybe 10 or 12 students that sign up. I had 34 students sign up for this seminar. So I knew that I had tapped into something, sort of a nerve of interest in the student body. And I'll be offering it again now that I actually know something about it. But I realized I actually now know how much I don't know about the food system. It's just this vast, vast problem and policy challenge that we have. So I'm happy to offer it again this coming year. And I understand the class is booked again. So that's kind of gratifying that the student interest is still there. So I'd like to kick off with a kind of a thought exercise. So we just ate at the bunganut pig, the bunganut. Whatever you had for lunch or dinner today, I want you to just close your eyes. Right? Really, just close your eyes and re-envision the meal that you have in front of you. I don't care if it was Taco Bell, something you cooked from your garden, something someone else cooked for you. Just envision that meal. What I want you to ask is, what do you care about that meal? What do you care about your food? Where did that food come from? If you ate at a restaurant, why did you walk into that restaurant and assume the food was going to be good or at least not make you sick? What do you actually care about? Because you can come back in, right? That's really what this is in many ways designed to stimulate in the student body and at a talk like this, is learning more about what's going on in our food system, where your food comes from, all the regulation and market forces at play, and it's a vast, vast topic. So what I'd like to do is just a quick overview of the food system. And I want to, we are going to get to farm to table, but to understand what farm to table is, you really have to understand what the conventional, what I'll call the conventional food system is. The system that's getting, you know, asparagus to you in the winter from Peru, right? Washington apples to you in the middle of the summer. Salmon, which I had tonight for dinner, right? In Tennessee, how does this get here, right? Our current food system makes possible meals for us, a food menu that would have been inconceivable in Middle Tennessee 70 years ago, right? Inconceivable, right? And we just expect it now. You walk into your Kroger or whatever, you walk in Publix, and you assume there better be asparagus there because I want asparagus tonight. Where are the Brussels sprouts? Oh, I'll check in the back. We do, we have some more Brussels. Where's all this food coming from? Right? Amazing statistic. If you were to shut, right, the five boroughs of New York City, stop all traffic coming in, there would be enough food in New York City, if you gathered it all, to feed the people of New York City for 3 days. They have a three-day food supply in New York City. Constantly, though, it's moving in, right? Catering to demand. So I want to talk about that conventional food system, tracking food from farms to post-consumer even. And then I want to talk about the law of food. That's kind of what we eventually get to studying in my class. Just give you a sense of how crazy and just disjointed the policy world is that's focused on our food. And then we'll talk about the new food movement, sort of rewiring the system. We want to ask, like, what is that about? Is it real? Is it just a bunch of hipsters, you know, who want to buy tomatoes that were grown down the road? And we can explore what is involved in that big umbrella called the new food movement. So the two big picture themes are that the conventional food system is a highly industrialized, highly regulated food production, processing, supply, and consumption economy. It has a vast footprint. It's global, right? Our food is global, right here in Nashville, Tennessee. It's highly, highly economically efficient. It is super, super efficient, right? That you can get asparagus from Peru in the middle of the winter here in Middle Tennessee, and it's not that expensive. And it's highly depersonalized. Do you know who grew your asparagus? Do you care? Do you know, you know, all you really know is the clerk at the Kroger. You might know that person if you go there enough. Maybe someone on the wait staff. You might know a chef or two in town. But beyond that, just sort of haphazard, do you really know anything about your food? Probably not. And we'll contrast that with the new food movement, which is trying to capture a bunch of themes that are pushing back on this, emphasizing local food sources, local economy, ecological efficiency in addition to economic efficiency, and liberty to choose your food, to produce your food the way you want to, and repersonalizing or personalizing the food system. So, you know, if you're a member of a community agriculture, you know the farmer, right? Does that mean, do you care about that is the question. Do you care to know the farmer or does it not matter to you? You clearly don't know the farmer in Peru who grew the asparagus you might have eaten, right? And then the problem with the new food movement is it's expensive to support. It's also, a lot of it is illegal. And that's the result of our conventional food system responding to policy demands that now are making much of the new food movement bumping up against regulations. I call that the Uber effect, right? Uber's great. How many people have taken an Uber? Yeah. I still haven't, so I don't really know how great it is. But Uber is illegal, right? I mean, when it came on the scene, it's flat out illegal. And, you know, asked for forgiveness, not permission. They just started doing it, and then they figured, when we get pushback, we'll throw the lawyers at them. But now they are getting a lot of pushback, right? So they were illegal. And yet, a lot of people love Uber. So what is the conventional food system? Here's a very, very simple diagram, like breaking down the food systems to a couple of its big components, right? So we produce food at the farm. It's processed. Most of it is processed at some level or another. It's distributed. It's got to get to us. We buy it retail, and we consume it, right? And there are a lot of stories behind each of those parts of the diagram. One of the most important is distribution. The refrigerated truck is what initially made possible getting something like a Washington apple here in Middle Tennessee in fresh condition. And once that was possible, processing and production started to consolidate into huge industrial operations, sort of get the apples on the trucks, moving fast to a vast distribution network, and then into a retail network that clearly, as I'll show you in a few minutes slides, you know, it's not like mom and pop groceries anymore. So this system has become efficient by becoming highly industrialized, aggregated, consolidated. Here's a more detailed food chain, food processing chain. This is the Washington apple. It's grown, it's harvested, it's washed, graded, waxed. It's got to be packed, 40-pound cartons, distributed, processed. Some apples are processed into something else, applesauce, pie fillings, package. Then again, right, from the carton to something that's going to make it more retail friendly. It's retailed, prepared in your home or in the restaurant, consumed. Then we have disposing and composting, the post-consumption handling of food waste. Going to get a little more complicated here, too. This is another one, food supply chain of the U.S. broiler chicken market. I have to think about the inputs, right? So soy and corn is used to feed the chickens, poultry. Some fish is also used in the meal. And we produce usually about 100,000 chickens in a single facility. The United States of America goes through 6 billion broiler chickens a year. That's billion with a B. 6 billion a year, right, that are produced and consumed in the United States alone. Now we're going to add money into the situation. So this is an economist's view of, well, we've got up at the top left, farm input supply, pesticides, whatever the farmer's using to produce. And blue is the movement of the food system to getting food to us. And the red lines are money going back up the system. So farm supply to farm production. We have what are called first line handlers. They might be the ones who are putting the apples in the crates and getting them into the manufacturers are turning them into applesauce or pie filling. We have wholesale and logistics, that's really the distribution that gets it to retail food stores, institutional buyers, food and beverage services, restaurants, all to get it to that far right green box, the consumer. So it all winds up there, and the money then goes back up the chain, right, along the way. Yet even, you know, the sort of, what's the scale of this? So this shows you crop production on the left, and then how we turn it into edible food, and what happens in between. So for example, this is billion pounds. We produce 42 billion pounds of wheat a year, right? And that gets processed into food, animal production. We export food, we import food, right? And ultimately we wind up with, you know, vegetables, dairy products, fresh vegetables, and those are your basically what we're eating as a result of crop production. It includes protein, right? We use crops to feed cattle, pigs, and chickens in particular. Interesting point here is you see this arrow that sort of drops out of that. It's called waste, 30% to 50%. Actually, that arrow is really dropping out of the entire system. If we go back, in every one of these points, there's waste. And we do estimate that of all the food that is grown, crop food in particular, 30% of it never gets eaten in the United States. And there's all sorts of reasons for that. I'll talk about some of them in detail later, but you know, if the potato isn't up to McDonald's standards, it doesn't get into the food system. And it's actually more costly to find a way to put it into the system, right? Because it's so industrialized and so specific that it's difficult to say, well, these potatoes don't fit the McDonald's system that I'm a grower for. Throw them away. That's cheaper than trying to find a use for them, right? And that happens at every stage of the way. It's also partly consumers' faults, the consumers' fault. So you walk into a Kroger and you see a bin of okra or tomatoes and there's only two left, you go, I don't want those two. No one else wanted those two, why would I want those two? Right? So you ask for more, and they come along and they take those two, and they, you know, how many times have you walked into Kroger and they're just throwing tomatoes away, and you're going, are those really no good? No, they're just not good enough to sell at the Kroger, right? They're just taking up space, no one's going to buy. So that's part of the problem as well. We are part of the problem. Okay, now we can take this food system and we need to sort of nest it in with other social and economic systems. So this is a way of thinking, right, that money, the red line, is moving from us to up the system, sending signals, more apples here, you know. We don't like Brussels sprouts. Actually, we do, you know, so suddenly Brussels sprouts are in. Food is moving from left to right through these farm input supply, farm production, first line handlers and manufacturers, the boxes we saw. But then we need to think, well, this food system is just, it's not like it's just out there on its own. It interacts with, right, the environment. Science and technology, they're constantly improving, we think, our food. Social organizations, policies, markets, right? So the food system, it just touches all aspects of life and society and policy. And if you really want to go crazy, that is the global food system. So we put, my students and I put that up on the board and we all walked up and looking around, you know, like, whoa! But this is amazing, you know, it's got everything. Like what, it's so integral to our lives, the food system. It touches everything and law and policy have a big hand to play. Right? So that's just kind of the macro, super big picture. Getting your hands on this is, we spent weeks just trying to figure this out. Right? What's the point of thinking about policy if you don't understand the system itself? Just some interesting slides we looked at in class. So this is where all the money's going, basically. And so at the very tippy top, you see there's a little bracket across, and these are years, right? That's legal, right? Legal and accounting, so not much, not many lawyers out there as part of the food system. But then you have advertising, finance and insurance. Energy is that orange, that first big band. That's the amount of energy it takes to fuel the food system. Energy is the, looks like bricks. The orange is food services, so that's the restaurant industry. Red is retail trade, blue is wholesale trade, transportation. And you see way down here, that's farming. So you'd think, you know, with food system, it must be all about farming. The farming is not really where all the money is, right? It's this enormous economy built on top of farming, right? That depends on farming. And I'll tell you, just as a sidebar, farming in general, the farm lobby, if you think of the farm lobby, there's this enormous economy on top of the farm world that is out there promoting and defending sort of farming practices, right? Because they depend on that. This is the value added to GDP. This is probably easier to, you know, so in other words, again, here's the food economy, food service, eating and drinking places, so restaurants, the blue bar. Textile apparel, so the Department of Commerce refers to this as the food and fiber economy. So it's producing fiber as well, small part of it. Food, beverage, and tobacco manufacturing is the yellow bar, fishing and forestry, and then farms again. You know, you realize farms really are, you know, they're not insignificant, but they're down there at the bottom supporting all this on top of them. Our food expenditures. So this shows us that we our food budget is about roughly half of it is to eat food at home, a little over a third to eat food out, and then we spend about a sliver on schools and then other. And then where do we get our calories? Most of our calories are consumed at home, then restaurants and schools. This is interesting too in terms of consolidation. That's a big theme of the class. This shows the consolidation of the grocery store world. So the blue line at the bottom is the share of our dollars spent in grocery stores that go to the top four grocery stores. So you see it's grown from under 20% to almost 40% of all of the expenditures in grocery stores are in four grocery store chains. Costco, Sam's, Kroger, and I forget, there's one other, I can't remember. I think it's a West Coast. There's four, right? And I think the top 20, it's over half the market. So this is a consolidation of the grocery store world. Okay, so that's just sort of bombarding you with a sense that this is a really, really monstrous system. A couple of themes. One, it's industrialization, consolidation. It is very expensive to step out of the system if you're part of it, because it's geared to get, you know, the right kind of tomatoes from big farming operations into big distribution and wholesaling operations, into big retail grocery store operations, into big restaurant chains, or our homes. And if you want to step out of that system, there's not a parallel system really in place yet that's national in scope. All right, so you go to a restaurant, you like to walk in assuming you're not going to get sick and die. Why is that? Why do you trust Taco? I don't know if you trust Taco Bell, but you know. Why do you trust? Why do we go to the Bunga Nut Pig and go, hey, I'd like the grilled salmon Caesar salad, and think it's all going to be okay? Well, we have a regulatory system that has grown up around the food system to make sure, right? And you know, bad things used to happen, and we step in with regulation to make those less and less of a problem for us. So, real quick spin through the food regulatory chain. And the big theme here is it's not just, there's not the U.S. Food Agency. Now, you know, there's the Food and Drug Administration, but there's also the USDA and yada, 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 many, many, many other agencies that have roles to play. So just agriculture, for example, USDA, obviously, United States Department of Agriculture, very big regulatory and supporting agency, right? So they support farming and they regulate farming. Food safety for meat and poultry and processed eggs, subsidies for farms to support a stable farm industry, and they provide subsidized insurance for farming. A lot of that is there to make sure that even though farming's not that big part of the food system, that it's there, it's stable. Right? We have a fairly stable food supply coming out of our farming sector. Environmental Protection Agency regulates pesticide use, water pollution from farms, although they are in a special class of their own in terms of how they are regulated. The FDA regulates unprocessed eggs. Bureau of Land Management in the West plays a very big role in grazing. A lot of our cattle production in the West is on federal public lands, and those ranchers have to get permits from the BLM, Bureau of Land Management. Fish and Wildlife Service and the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration regulate fisheries, both freshwater and marine. Department of Energy, biofuel subsidies. So you saw corn production go through the roof about a decade ago. That was to fuel the biofuel program. And the Department of Labor regulates agricultural employment. So a lot of agencies just there on the farm have a role to play. In terms of processing and manufacturing, again, USDA inspects slaughterhouses, process egg facilities. Food and Drug Administration, food safety for all food products not regulated by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. NOAA and Marine Fisheries have a seafood inspection program. At the retail side, the Federal Trade Commission is there to protect us from claims. Example, just I used to practice law before I taught law, and one of our clients was Ragu Spaghetti, right? And our client was sued because on the label on the spaghetti sauce, they said, like mama used to make, and the FTC said, that's deceptive, because people might think that we were like what? Old ladies are sitting in the Ragu plant making spaghetti? And they said, well, you know, and we thought, okay, so we compromise was tastes like mama used to make. I can argue with that, right? So the Federal Trade Commission is regulating claims, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. USDA, labeling, certification standards, and the Food and Drug Administration, again, labeling for food not regulated by the USDA. Consumers, we have HHS that is trying to design, you know, dietary and nutrition policies, school diets. We'll look at FTC labeling in a minute. So the HHS is out there trying to make us eat healthier. USDA, consumer education. The Food and Nutrition Service develops nutritional guidelines. EPA regulates our drinking water. Post-consumer, we have waste management as part of that. So, you know, where does your food waste go when you throw it away? It goes to a landfill, most likely. And EPA regulates landfills. FDA and USDA do limit post-consumer uses of some food to ensure safety. But by and large, the food waste issue is of growing concern to EPA in particular, because we're taking up a lot of landfill space with food waste. And it so happens that Nashville is now a test laboratory for a big food waste initiative that's being pursued by the Environmental Law Institute and the Natural Resources Defense Council and several other. They're getting support from EPA and others. They're trying to figure out how can we reduce food waste at the grocery store and restaurant level and improve food biomass. So we're building a big combustor here that will produce compost very quickly out of food waste that can't be moved through the system, you know, so that we're not actually wasting it. So for example, one initiative is a really smart guy who built an app. It's like Uber for food waste. And this app, if you're a restaurant, you get the app. And if you're if you're a public service or social service agency that's delivering food to needy, you know, how do you know where the extra tomatoes are that day? You get on your app, right? And Uber has actually volunteered to give their drivers are idle, they can pick up a food app delivery and get a little payment from Uber. So the Uber drivers have the app and they'll say, okay, I need to go to, you know, the Bunganut Pig and get their leftover tomatoes that they know they're not going to be able to serve tomorrow and get it down to the food kitchen. Reduce the food waste, because you know you can't expect restaurants to start driving their food around, right? So you get this you know, platform technology that provides that help. There's just so many other agencies. Center for Disease Control, right? If you get that, suddenly people start dying because they ate, you know, food. Like, well, what did they eat? Where did it come from? It was spinach from that farm in California. Boom, that's the CDC trying to track that down. Patent and Trade Office. The intellectual property of food is an enormous topic, right? So a lot of food activists, to them, the devil is Monsanto, because Monsanto owns patents on Roundup Ready corn, Roundup Ready that, and they don't let the farmers use their seed again. You got to buy seed every year from Monsanto. Why? It's their intellectual property. That's how our patent system works. It's just how it works. If we didn't give Monsanto that monopoly, they might not have ever produced Roundup Ready corn, etc. So there's a trademarking, copywriting, right? So you might have heard about the Cracker Barrel controversy recently here, right? Where Cracker Barrel restaurant chain decided they were going to move into grocery stores with a line of meats, and Kraft Cracker Barrel cheese said, no, 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 we own Cracker Barrel in grocery stores. That's our trademark. And they won. Cracker Barrel is a restaurant It's not a food product that's sold in retail stores. So Cracker Barrel had to drop the Cracker Barrel name from their line of meats, and it's called the Old Country Store, right, line of meats, because, and they still have the logo that's the Cracker Barrel logo, because Kraft didn't own that. I mean, that was a, I can't tell you how many lawyers billed hours on that lawsuit, right? That was knock down, drag out. And that's where, you know, intellectual property comes into play. Department of Transportation regulates food shipping, vehicle standards, DHS, Homeland Security. There are Border Patrol. There are, you know, sort of import and export agency. Department of Justice and FTC enforce the laws, and the EPA occasionally gets involved with farms under the Endangered Species Act. This is a concise guide to the U.S. food regulatory system provided by one of our government agencies, and I thought, wow, that just clarifies everything, right? Because then it just tells you, my gosh, I need to keep track of all those agencies? I mean, this thing was, we were looking at it in class going, wow, which we wanted to give up, right? So again, it's a complicated system, therefore it's a complicated regulatory system. There's no one agency you go to and say, you know, have you got this whole thing covered? No, it's dozens and dozens of this is just federal agencies. I'm leaving out state agencies. So I had a student in class who actually did a lot of the background work on this matrix of agencies. He said, I want to understand how this works, Professor Rule. I'm like, great, go for it. and he brought it together in this very clever way. He made himself a shrimp and grits dinner. And then he sat back and thought, okay, what government agencies, thinking right from the very source of the corn and the grits, the shrimp, the scallions, he had some bread, he had a glass of wine, because wine is food, by the way. I mean, I consider it a food substance. You know, what agencies had a hand in my shrimp and grits dinner? Right, so, you know, he came up with this list. USDA, FDA, NOAA, regulating the shrimp fishery. It depends if it's wild or farmed. The EPA, pesticide use, FTC, consumer protection, you know, labeling on the grits, on the shrimp, patent and trade office, trademarks for the wholesalers, patents for some of the GMOs, local agencies, Department of Labor, you know, just a partial list. So when you sit down to your next dinner and you look at it and you go, whoa, I've got all those agencies protecting me, I think. Hot topic, breaking news. How many heard about the new food labels that we're going to see, right? Okay, so labels, labels, labels. You're bombarded with labels when you walk into a grocery store. Look on your egg carton, you know, free range, omega 8, I don't even know what omega, you know. What do all these things mean? What are all these labels doing for us? We have organic. This iodized salt, did you know that your salt has no trans fat? Why would they put that on a salt carton? Like, no trans fat. Well, I hope not. It's salt. And that says no calories. Zero calories. Yeah, it's salt. So are you really helping us here? Does that mean the salt that doesn't say no trans fat has trans fat in it? No, of course not. There was another one, no, GMO free. Of course it's, no, not GMO, gluten free. Gluten-free salt, well, it, yeah, that's, right, non-GMO project. Okay, so very quickly, we have a vast regulatory system governing food labels. We have mandatory labeling, mandatory disclosures, that's the nutrition facts panel that's now changing, and I'll talk about that in a second. Some allergen labeling, so you see the label, you know, if this food product was manufactured at a facility that may have had contact with peanuts and whatever else. And some product attributes, that's a proposed, so I'll get to that in a second. A lot of voluntary labeling, so you don't have to put the label on, but if you do, you might be regulated in terms of what you say. Product attribute claims, like healthy, tastes good, right? Health effect claims, right? Nutrient content claims beyond those that are labeled, you know, high in omega-3. That's not a required disclosure, but if you if you slap that on your egg carton, you have to be able to back that up. Product origin claims, descriptive attributes. Product origin claims, you know, we have our trademark system, and then there's the global mark system, you know, so champagne can only come from Champagne, the Champagne district in France, and we were fighting over Swiss cheese, and you know, Budweiser finally got at the World Trade Organization level the right to say we actually were the first Budweiser, even though there's a city in Germany or somewhere over there that, you know, was calling itself Budweiser. What is organic? Anyone like to buy organic food? The FDA actually does not have a definition of what organic is. They have a long list, a regulation that says what has to be done or can't be done for you to call your food organic, but they could never come up with a definition of what organic means. It's just sort of what it doesn't mean. Okay. What is natural? The FDA is right now asking the public, the comment period closed a couple weeks ago, should we regulate claims that food is natural? What does natural mean? Right, so they're saying, hey, we'd like you to tell us, is it appropriate to define the term natural? If so, how should we define natural? And how should the agency determine the appropriateness of the term on food labels? What does natural mean? Right now, that's just something they slap on a label. Oh, natural. I guess that salt was probably natural. I assume so. So the FDA, and they've gotten hundreds of thousands of comments. Should they regulate and define that term natural? Sell-by, use-by, best-by. In most of the country, some states regulate these, but there's no federal regulation requiring these or even saying what they are about. The sell-by label is a market-based phenomenon. Right, sell by, use by. It's the product producers don't want you to ever open that, you know, Activia yogurt and have it be moldy. Right, so they tell you use by, or fresh until, a date that is actually way before you actually could safely consume it. Grocery stores do not have to remove products on their shelves that have passed the sell by. No requirement, but you know what? They do. About a day or two before, you'll find the manager's specials, right? The, you know, things that are about to expire. Most of those products are perfectly safe to eat well beyond that date. Well beyond that date. And there are guides that can tell you what is and what isn't and how much, you know, how far. But this is just sort of something that's the only thing that's actually required is on baby formula, infant formula. That's a required use by. And so this is also a question, should this be regulated? And then we have the new label. All right, so there's the before and the after. What's the biggest difference?
Calories,
right? Calories and, right, so this is the one that pops out, right? More calories? Well, that wasn't a big controversy, right? That line right there, I'll bet you lawyers and lobbyists total spent, I would conservatively estimate $100 million fighting over that line right there. Added sugar. That's the real big change.
Is that in addition to the 12 grams, so it's really 22?
So total sugars here, okay, right, includes 10 grams added sugars, right? So the argument is, sugar's sugar, that's the one side of the debate is, well, who cares if it's added or not? Well, the other side of the debate is, well, we'd like to know how much sort of is unnatural or was added, and there are arguments that different forms of sugar have different metabolic properties that affect people differently. So you want to know if it's high fructose corn syrup or what, right? That's the big difference. So just to, here's the what's different, right? So what's different is the number of servings per container is a little larger. Calories per serving now pops out. right? Because bottom line is that's probably the most important number up there, and people need to keep track of calories more than they keep track of everything else on here, you know, in general. They updated some of the daily values. They took out vitamin A and added potassium. Probably the most important one is vitamin D. Forget a vitamin, vitamin D, that's right, they've put vitamin D in. Part of that is that we're because we're all fanatical with sunscreen now, many of us are having low vitamin D levels. It's not good. So they want us to, the nutritionists are saying, go get more vitamin D. The new added sugars is, that was the big controversy. And, you know, so here you can get your, that's your vegan, gluten-free, soy-free, antibiotic-free, raw, non-GMO, organic, fat-free, low-carb meal is a plate of ice cubes. Right, so you could actually, I think, now label the bags of ice, all of these things, safely, and they would, now you would know, you know, your ice is non-GMO. Okay, let's talk about the new food movement a little bit, right? So we're shifting gears. And I don't know if this will work, but I'll give it a shot. So my assumption was that many of my students took my class because they were really into the new food movement, farm to table, local, raw this, organic that. And actually, they turned out to be very skeptical of it. Many of them came to the conclusion that, you know, if climate change and or the, you know, economic distress, whatever, they'd rather have the conventional food system available to them than have all gone, you know, locavore, organic, etc. They want to get that food, right? And they also felt that I'm sort of generalizing, that, you know, a lot of the new food movement was actually adding expense, when many of our food challenges are getting food to people who don't have the budget to buy healthy food. So, you know, sort of this paradox, right? Now, I don't know if this will work, but if you've seen this, let me know. Let's see if I can get this to run. So this is the new food movement in the extreme. Oh, I don't know if I'm going to have sound. That's a good question. Oh, we don't have sound? Oh, don't worry about it. I'm not, it looks like I'm... Well, okay. Don't worry about it. It's only 2 minutes. I'll tell you what it was about. Anyone watch Portlandia? Yeah, so this is the scene where the couple goes into the restaurant and the waitress comes up and says, hi, my name's, you know, Anne. I'll be serving you tonight. And they say, well, tell... we're interested in the chicken, the roast chicken. Can tell us about the chicken? And she starts saying, well, it's braised. No, about the chicken. Oh, the chicken was, you know, raised at a local farm. It's all local. In a wooded, open, you know, open range. It was fed local hazelnuts. And it's going on. And they're like, oh, that's great, that's great. Like, can you tell us a little more about, you know, was the chicken happy? And she says, you know, this is deeper than I'm personally, I'll go ask the chef. So she comes and she walks back with a file. Actually, this is your chicken. It was named Colin. And was grown by this, you know, she names the farmer. And they're very interested and they decide they're not so sure about they don't know enough about the farmer. Is this an ethical farmer? Is this a good farmer? And they just get up and leave. They say, hold our seats. We're going to drive the 30 miles to go talk to the farmer about our chicken. So that's sort of the new food movement in the extreme, right? again, come back to this theme. Conventional food system is what we could call a transactional model. It's just about buying food, moving food down the chain, right? Farmer buys the input, farmer sells to the wholesaler, et cetera, and you go to the store or the restaurant and you buy your food. It's transactional, right? It's a series of transactions. It's led to consolidation, huge transportation network. We have very little food knowledge. We have very little knowledge about our food. And we have no real relationship with our with anyone else in the food system, right? Other than that transaction, right? So the new food movement is more about building a relationship model. The food supply chain is shortened. What I mean by that is, you know, if you're going local, especially if you're in with a CSA, you know, you buy straight from your farmer, your farmer's market. You're buying local. We don't need all the distribution chains that transactions that the conventional system relies on. Local food sourcing concentrates transport network and tightens relationships. We have more knowledge as a result, right? So the whole farm-to-table movement is you can walk into, you know, Husk or Etch and say, there's the chalkboard and it says, here's where we got tonight's chicken, here's where we sourced tonight's greens, right? The Hermitage uses the Glen Farm, right? You know, so do you care about that or not? You know, apparently there's a market for it. And then the consumer can establish relationships within the local network. So that's the big picture difference. The new food movement is actually a big collection of movements, and there's a lot of strange bedfellows phenomenon. I mean, you've got libertarians who are like, you know, if I want to drink raw milk, no one should be able to stop me from drinking raw milk. Well, you know, the reason we don't really like you to drink raw milk is people die. When it, you know, not all, everyone, but some people die. That's why we regulated the milk industry. It's everything from libertarians to communitarians, right? So the politics don't always line up, but the themes generally do. So just really quickly, you know, what are the big activist points in the new food movement? School lunch reform. It's actually a pushback now on Michelle Obama's school lunch reform movement because the School Lunch Ladies, which is actually an organization called the School Lunch Ladies, not lying, say it's impossible. It's way too expensive. We can't deliver the snappy, snazzy food you want us to deliver. Right? So there's pushback there. Animal welfare is a big issue. The anti-GMO movement is strong in some parts of the country. Vermont has tried to impose GMO labeling. The federal government, so far, it's courts have said it's preempted by federal regulation. You can't make people do GMO labeling. GMO is a very divisive topic. There are those who think it's just a non-issue and those who make it the issue of the day. Organic, of course, you're familiar with that. The obesity crisis in the United States is wrapped into our food system and is very much terms that often are associated with the obesity crisis are the food desert and food swamp on the right-hand side. So in our urban areas in particular, you have many urban areas, especially low income, that have no access to healthy food choices. They don't have grocery stores like a Kroger within easy reach where they can get fresh produce. Instead, they get a lot of fast food, fried, etc., right? You'd say, well, the answer to that is put some Krogers in there. Well, it's too expensive. And the bottom line is they're finding that even if you put, subsidize like fresh produce into these areas, the people are working three jobs. They have no time to buy the raw produce and make a meal. That their only option is to pick up a fast food option or something that's processed, highly processed food. Local food, the locavore movement, food sovereignty is as Nashville decide, you know, we want to just be completely self-sufficient in our food system. There are nations that are focused more on self-sufficiency of food, so that issue. Urban agriculture, you know, chickens in your backyard, it's illegal in many cases. Nashville's looking at that. I'm pretty sure Brentwood is not. Farm bill reform, every 5 years we cycle through the farm bill and decide where are we going to send the subsidies, what do we want our agriculture to look like, can we incentivize it this way, that way. Cage-free, free-range, CSAs and farmers markets is a big part of this, food safety. Farmland preservation, through desert food swamps, farm to table in schools. So how can we get farmers linked up with schools? Farm worker rights, big labor issue there. Big industrialized agriculture is not necessarily kind to its employees, and so the Department of Labor is developing policies there. EPA, nutrition labeling, we went through marketing to children. This is, you know, comes back. So the whole cereal advertisement controversy from decades ago, well, you still see the marketing to children, sugary drinks, the fast food and sugary drinks policy. You know, New York City tried to shut down the sugary drinks industry by limiting the size of the cups, and that was considered, you know, paternalism, and also was not done the right way legally, so that's put on the table. The anti-antibiotic movement and the whole trade and globalization, anti-globalization movement is also wrapped up into food, right? So big collection of issues that you could throw in the new food movement because they're all pushing back on the conventional system. Lots of legal issues, so urban agriculture is going to bump up against zoning regulation. Why were the zoning regulations there? Like, you can't have farm animals in, you know, this part of Nashville or Brentwood because people don't want to live next to farm animals. Now some people want farm animals again, right? So how do you balance those competing concerns? Commercial kitchen regulations are bumping up against the new food movement. There's a great farmers market in Knoxville. So went over there once, and there was a operation selling these fabulous pepper sauces. And I'm a pepper sauce freak, so I tasted one of these. Oh man, these are great. You know, I got to talking with him. He asked me, you know, he's kind of a curmudgeonly guy. Like, what do you do? I'm like, oh, I'm a lawyer. Like, what's your problem? You're like, well, here, I'm going to tell you a story. So he uses the salt fermentation method to make his pepper sauces. No cooking involved. But the Tennessee Health Department came in and said, you're selling food, you have to use a commercial grade kitchen. I was like, well, I'm not cooking anything. Doesn't matter. He had to spend $16,000 to come into compliance. Right. So, you know, just little details. These regulations are out there and they're bumping up against the new food movement or vice versa. Direct-to-consumer sales restrictions. There are limits on how much a producer can sell directly to consumers. Depends on the product, et cetera. Labeling claims and requirements. What is the guy who makes the pepper sauce, what's his label supposed to look like? Right? You have to put all that nutritional information on. The raw milk issue is a big one. The anti-intellectual, the anti-Monsanto movement, right? But you've got to be careful as you enter into this, you know, new kinds of production that you're not stumbling on patents or trademark. Believe me, Monsanto will find you and they will. Certification systems, you know, what does it mean, you know, gluten-free? Gluten-free, who's certifying that? Private certification systems in particular, causing controversy. And then food safety. So lots of legal issues that, you know, we explored in the class. One in particular we looked at was the community-supported agriculture, right? So I got to know a local CSA and visited a few times and, you know, grabbed some bags of greens and stuff. I realized that you need a lot of turnip greens to make very much. I came in, look, I got some turnip greens. It boils down to like one. So I'm sort of learning my way through actual, you know, direct consumer sales. But they have lots of legal issues. It's a great idea, but what business entity should you choose? You know, someone gets sick on your spinach and dies, they're going to sue the producer. Is it an individual whose entire assets are on the line? Limited liability corporation, small business, partnership. How do you share risk? There have been controversies around the country where, you know, the CSA members complain, well, we really wanted, you know, more heirloom tomatoes this time, or hey, where are all the greens? Well, we had a crop failure. Well, give us our money back. No, that was risk sharing. Where's that? Is that written down? Do you need a contract? You really want to say, is that you know, new foodie to say, oh, so glad to have you be a part of the CSA, sign this contract. That seems very transactional all of a sudden, right? Interns and worker shares. So many of these CSAs, you know, they have interns who they work very, you know, laboriously. Some of the workers take their pay in food. Some of these arrangements violate Department of Labor standards. What kind of insurance should you carry? How do you bump up against the recent Food Safety Modernization Act? There are limits in terms of revenue, but when you bump, if you're a successful CSA, you're going to go from the small to big farm, and suddenly waves of regulation land on top of you. Right, so just that one piece of the new food movement, the CSA, which, you know, is a great idea, but it doesn't fit our conventional system neatly. Do we revise it, the regulatory system, so that if you do get sick from a CSA, you don't have any recourse? Right. Or should they be treated just like, Chipotle? So we're exploring that in the seminar, and, you know, many policy think tanks are doing this too. How could we integrate this? Yeah, it's relatively small. You add up all of the new food movement, it's not, you know, a big economy. But the people that are in it are passionate about it, and they're finding that the regulations that grew as part of our conventional food system are an obstacle to fulfilling what people just want to do. Well, I have time for questions.
But, yeah? You brought Chipotle, and I didn't think about it until you said it. What was that all about? I mean, they were sued, their food was supposed to be bad, and then it was not bad, it was the same thing.
Yeah, you know, we think that, this sort of goes back to the point is you walk into a Taco Bell or a Chipotle and you assume, I'm not going to get sick. But they have vast supply chains, right? And so not much has to go wrong, right? Some E. coli on some spinach that then gets into your little taco bowl and boom, right? And then they of course took the hit as that transactional model where, well, we bought it from Chipotle. Chipotle is the problem. So that's what happened.
I heard somebody planted E. coli and they were trying to defend.
I don't know about whether there was a
E.
coli warfare or something like that. Something to talk about.
Yes. This is not such a legal question, but why is it that Europe is not as supportive of GMOs as the United States is?
That's a very good question. In general, although there are many exceptions, the European regulatory model is more precautionary than the United States model. So in Europe, if you know, this is a gross generalization, but they put the burden of proof on something new to prove it's safe. And many of our laws put the burden of proof on our regulatory bodies to prove something is not safe, right? So it's shifting the burden of proof. So they use what's called the precautionary principle for many of their regulatory programs, although not across the board. For example, smoking, you can smoke anywhere you want in Europe, whereas we've banned it, you know, much more so. So it's not across the board true, but they are very, very wary of the GMO problem. The counter to that is, the pro-GMO argument is that that's not going to have any effect on you. It's not like you're eating the GMOs. You're eating chicken or salmon. Where there is concern, in particular, is environmental concern. You know, what if the GMO stock gets into the wild? So the FDA recently approved GMO salmon, right? So the eggs of the salmon are produced in Canada, and the salmon are raised in an inland farm in Panama, right? And there's no way for them ever to get into the ocean. That's the argument. And then the food is processed in Panama and shipped back to the United States or Canada. So the GMO is kind of twofold. One is, if the GMO stock ever gets into the wild, will it interbreed with wild and then sort of change the evolutionary course of the wild salmon? And the other argument is, you know, is it unhealthy? And there's so far, I'm certainly no expert, but I have yet to see any conclusive scientific evidence that it is unhealthy, right? But the European model would be, well, maybe we need to know 50 years of experience before we can make that claim. On the other hand, how would you know if you don't start using it? So it's sort of a conundrum in that sense.
You mentioned that the new food movement is by and large more expensive than the traditional system. And can you comment a little bit more about some of the segments of the food market in terms of what percentage or how big the new food is compared to the traditional? And I'm thinking of, for example, the artisan brewing movement that started very small and now it's gotten the attention of the InBevs and Anheuser-Busch's, that they're getting worried that all of a sudden they're losing a lot of market share. I'm sure there's lots of other segments, but can you just give us an idea of the scale of some of those segments?
Yeah, so last I checked, so the organic produce is growing, but still very small. It's in the single digits percentage of total produce, but it's growing. And it is more expensive. And I was in the Kroger the other day where they've got signs that are like, new, less expensive organic produce. And still like, I mean, I was shopping for a red pepper, and they were out of regular red peppers, whatever the price was. I walked down, organic, one red organic red pepper was $5. I'm like, change the meal. I don't need a $5 red pepper. So organic food remains expensive. Organic food, there's a lot wrapped up in what that means. Again, there's no definition, it's a set of practices. It's not that they can't use pesticides, they have to use certain kinds of pesticides. They can still use copper, and manure is not necessarily good for the environment. Organic farming per unit takes up more land because it's not as efficient. So there are pros and cons to all of these. So you asked about artisans. So we actually, one field trip was to the Jackalope Brewery, and we got the tour and the tasting, and then we had Will Cheek, who's probably one of the state's top alcohol beverage lawyers, explained to us the whole history of Tennessee and state regulation of alcohol. And of course, that's now very big shift with wine sales in grocery stores. I was in my Kroger the other day, and they've got the wine stocked with the sign saying, 8 a.m. July 1st, we start selling this. 8 a.m. And I thought, and I looked at it, they had it all stocked. And I was like, this is actually pretty good wine selection. I mean, there's going to be a real battle between them and the wine and liquor stores. The whole resurgence of the artisan distilleries. So if you are making bourbon and the first drop that comes out of your still is taxed, federal tax dollars, and every year it sits in a barrel aging, you pay federal taxes. So you have this enormous upfront, right? And that was not a monopoly, but that was a barrier to entry. So you had all the big, the Jack Daniels and all these that, were sitting around, and they didn't see it coming because the smart new distilleries started doing, some vodka and gin and white. That's why you see White Lightning or moonshine back on shelves. You never saw that 10 years ago. They could get that on the shelf right away, get a revenue stream to pay the taxes, and then they're coming out with their high-end bourbons. And so suddenly all the big distillers like, oops, we didn't see that coming. So it was clever marketing. I don't know the percentages, though, of the craft and artisan brewery and distillery.
Well, just by and large in the entire food distribution network, does it seem like the new food movement is continuing to grow or has it plateaued? Do you see more growth, perhaps?
Yes, I see, in general, sectors of that movement growing. I think organic is going to continue growing. Artisan food in general will continue to grow. The CSA world will continue to grow. They add up to, an economic threat to the conventional, only on the margins. It's still a small percentage, but I see growth there. I don't see it as an answer to many of our big national policy issues. It's not the answer to our obesity problem. That's not just a food system problem. It's an economic, urban policy, income policy problem. So you're not going to throw CSAs at that and solve very much, or artisan breweries. Right? Or even organic food in its present state is not an answer to that. It's expensive.
Thank you.
to piggyback on this question, is it a fad? In-N-Out, I think, is a hamburger chain. You think you're in McDonald's on the West Coast, and then Marketing's will never open up a store where we can't get a truck in one day. So they'll never get farther east than Texas, is what I've seen in their marketing material. Do you think it's, and I think the privately owned company, it's one, I think she's one of the youngest billionaires, founder's granddaughter. Do you think it's being marketed more than it's actually occurring, they sourced from a local farm? I mean, is it a growth?
I think the locavore, local sourcing movement is growing. I don't know how far it will go. There was a recent study in which a bunch of researchers said, what if we committed to local sourcing defined as all food that anyone consumes in, and it was looking at major cities basically, must come from within 100 miles. Now you could, is that local or not? You can argue, because that's kind of the big issue, is 30 miles, 100 miles. But even if you did that, there are, obvious, cities that could never do it, pull it off. New York, Chicago, LA, they can't do it, right? Nashville, you probably could, but then you read the reporting, you're like, what would we be eating? We'd be eating, turnip greens and storing potatoes and are, you're not going to be eating Washington apples or asparagus from Peru. And so people probably would not have it. I think that what you're seeing is a movement that I just was in Austin, Texas, where we used to live, and a friend's husband is a farmer and he's growing oats in Texas. He's experimenting with it. Why? Because if he can get oats that are decent, he has an unlimited market. To market Texas oats in Texas would be fantastic. I have a friend, former partner of mine, who grows grass-fed Angus cattle, and he cannot grow them fast enough to get into local. He's outside of Austin, to get in all the restaurants in Austin that want to say local Angus cattle, grass-fed. Boom. Add $5 to the entree.
So the consumer demand.
It's consumer demand. Now, why? I don't know exactly why consumers demand that. Some of it, I think, is, again, this relational. It's helping the local economy. I know that there's that farm out there and, wherever, where I can drive by and say, I got that the other night, or, go down to Arrington or whatever. Maybe it makes you feel good. But as a national sort of objective, let's all eat local, we would bail on that so fast as consumers, right, that it's not even possible, really. Sure. Good question.
My reasons for going local are health.
I'm sorry?
My reasons for going local are health. So non-GMO, ensuring what are they eating, because I don't want my chickens laying those eggs to eat GMO corn.
Yeah, so you have more control.
Yeah.
You have more choice and control when it's local. And there's also the carbon footprint argument, and that's a little dicey, because you can run numbers and, the asparagus coming in from Peru actually can be lower carbon than per bunch than local. It all depends. Hothouse grown local tomatoes in the winter, not a good carbon footprint, but you're eating local, right? So there are trade-offs all throughout this new food movement, as there are in the conventional food movement. And people make their choices about, what they care about most. That's why I started this, was with what do you care about your food? Because that's going to drive your perception of the food system and where you want to kind of push on it or exit it. But you have to know about it first to know. Some people start as they learn more, suddenly I do care about that. I didn't even know that was an issue.
But it's also worth an investment because of savings in the healthcare system. Like, I don't know if this is going to hit a federal level, and it might be 100 years from now when it does. But the fact that we don't want to change our DNA, and we don't want this obesity, and we don't want this occurrence of diabetes, and we don't want this occurrence of Alzheimer's.
Sure. Well, there, as I said, there's a whole health and environmental set of issues. Again, the environmental, as an environmental lawyer, I get that. The health, I don't know that there's a way for the GMOs to get in our DNA, but again, the Europeans are like, well, we don't want to take that chance, so just no GMOs. I will say this, if you took GMOs out of the system completely, Roundup Ready corn is a GMO, you would be millions of people would not be alive but for Roundup Ready corn, not in the United States, elsewhere. So there are trade-offs every way you look at it. Thanks a lot. Really enjoyed this.
Welcome to Poets from the Neighborhood. I am Viraja R.
And I'm Sandy Coomer. We hope you'll enjoy the poems we'll be reading today, poems written by your friends and neighbors. I wrote this next poem, and the title is Rivers Within Us. We chase the steely wind that rises off the ridge, dive for yellow leaves just beyond our grasp. This is the game of luck we play when any nod of God might keep us safe one more day. Sometimes when we listen to the world shudder around us, totter on its spindle-thin legs, we grope like a child straining to find the umbilical cord, pull ourselves back in. We're desperate to see something kind when we look into humanity's eyes and fear we won't. You find what you look for, someone said, and I think that's mostly true. Still, I hope I'm surprised by turquoise skies roaming the back of the storm, the sacred heart of trillium daring to rise from the deeply patched underneath. Even something as simple as a blade of grass braving the crack in a driveway is reason enough to believe in miracles. What I'm saying is, there are rivers within us, whole galloping herds of horses, hummingbirds that beat their tiny hearts millions of times between the bee balm and the sage. Any moment now, we may open a door and enter a green field, and the knot of fear will be untied. The roots of a tree may curve beneath us and unearth our heart. This is how much the world needs us. The river may swing its wide current and catch us in its arms, a small blue spear of joy welcoming us home, while all around us the whole world whispers, "What took you so long?"
A Spring Haiku by Louis Colm. On a day in spring, horizons of sky and earth blend in one color. Thank you for watching Poets from the Neighborhood. We hope you'll join us again soon.